Tonight we are in a sandy region of eastern Oman, known as the Sharqiyah Sands, and we are looking for one of my all-time favorite scorpion species, known as the shield-tailed scorpion, and sometimes as the Arabian Giant Deathstalker. And they really are quite common, so we should have absolutely no issue finding several of them. This is a pretty good start to the night.
Right down here is quite a sizable shield-tailed scorpion, sometimes known as the Giant Arabian Deathstalker.
This one is a female, I believe. It's immediately obvious why they have the name shield-tailed scorpion. You can see that the first and especially the second metasomal segment are much wider than the rest of the tail. And this tail shape is unique to scorpions in the genus Apistobuthus. Uneven tail segments are quite rare in scorpions, and the purpose of these expanded segments is not really known. However, a couple things should be noted. First, on average, it does seem that this tail segment is a little bit wider in males. And second, the segment grows proportionally wider as the scorpion gets older. So for example, in very small juveniles, this character is completely absent. So these two things might point in the direction of a reproductive adaptation. However, these scorpions have been observed in courtship, and the purpose of the wide second segment still isn't known, so there might not be any correlation at all. Also, though not as uncommon in scorpions generally, in addition to having some wide metasomal segments, you might have also noticed that some parts of the tail are noticeably spiky. This is also relatively unique to the scorpion. There is a Trigonodactylus sharqiyahensis down here on the ground.
That is this little gecko right here. Not very large at all. Even though these geckos are fairly common around here, this is still quite a nice find. And the reason being, because this is an endemic species to Oman. Its specific epithet, sharqiyahensis, refers to the Sharqiyah Sands, which is the dune system that we are in right now. It's also almost endemic to this dune system, but they can be found in a couple outlying sand sheets, especially closer to the coast. What's unique about Trigonodactylus in this area is that there's webbing between the toes on the front feet. This is an adaptation that helps mostly with digging in the sand, especially when creating burrows.
And on top of that, I have noticed that they do fluoresce a little bit more brightly under ultraviolet light than the other lizards around here. A close second would be Stenodactylus doriae. There is one other Trigonodactylus species that can be found in Oman, and that is Trigonodactylus arabicus. That species can be found in a region called the Empty Quarter, mostly along the border of KSA and the Emirates, a location where I've been able to observe quite a few.
I was just about to let our gecko go, and there's a tiny little camel spider just scurrying around.
Right down here is a Scarabaeus bannuensis. That is a species of dung beetle. What's unique about these beetles is that generally speaking, most bugs out here produce only one type of track each. Meanwhile, these beetles leave two very distinct sets of tracks in the sand here. Obviously, the first type of track is just the normal one that they create when they're walking around in the sand. But because these are dung rollers, they create a completely different kind of track when they're pushing their ball around. Around here, these beetles subsist off of dromedary dung, and those are quite round to begin with, so the beetles don't have to make the balls themselves. And so, since the ball is already pre-made, all the beetle has to do is choose which one it prefers, and then move it away. So it's a bit more similar to takeout than fast casual. Though I haven't seen many of the beetles themselves, I have followed quite a few of their tracks, and it seems that they're very often over 100 meters long. The burrow that it makes to store the ball in the ground appears to be between a meter and a half meter into the ground. And the end goal, of course, is that the beetle larvae are going to feed on this dung to develop into pupae. Right down here is our second Apistobuthus pterygocercus. This small one right here. And you can see that at this size, they look a little bit more like your average scorpion. Those funny segments on the tail are reduced, but even without those funny tail segments, the species of scorpion is still unique out here. Across much of the land area on the Arabian Peninsula that's covered in dunes, this is the most gracile scorpion species that you can find. Or in other words, it tends to have longer limbs compared to its body. Among scorpions on the Arabian Peninsula, its shape is most comparable to scorpions in the genus Lyris, otherwise known as Deathstalkers, which is probably why these are sometimes referred to as Arabian Giant Deathstalkers. In addition to that, and this may not be the best time to point this out since we are looking at a juvenile,
This is potentially the largest species of scorpion that can be found on the Arabian Peninsula, and it's also one of the largest scorpions in the family Buthidae, which is the most diverse scorpion family. And speaking of the genus Apistobuthus, it contains only one other species, Apistobuthus susanae, and while that one is found in Iran, Iraq, and Kuwait, this one is found in Oman, the Emirates, Qatar, and KSA, of course. Here are the dromedaries I was mentioning earlier, and usually they're in a pen of some sort, but every so often you come across them just out and about like this. Well, my intention was not to wake them up, so I think I'm going to go now. Also, regarding those dromedaries we were just looking at, check this out. What often looks like a field of rocks on top of sand out here is just kilometers upon kilometers of camel dung just resting on the dunes. This rodent that we see on the ground is a Cheesman's gerbil. It might be fairly still right now, but as soon as I move, it'll dip back into its burrow, so I will camp it out for just a couple of minutes to see if I can catch it. Here it is, our Gerbillus cheesmani, and this species is without a doubt the most common mammal that you can find in these dunes. That's also true for the vast majority of dune systems on the Arabian Peninsula. So then it comes as no surprise that these are probably responsible for the plurality of vertebrate burrows that you can find in the dunes out here. The only thing that would be ahead of them is some of the small lizards that you can see during the day. And no offense to those lizards, but their burrows, ecologically speaking, are not nearly as impactful as those made by this gerbil here. These gerbils create burrows that are also used by many other animal species. And because there isn't another species out here that's providing this ecological service to this degree, these Cheesman's gerbils can certainly be considered a keystone species in this environment. And of course, there is something else quite obvious that also makes these a keystone species, and that is the fact that these are a very common prey species for a lot of different animals out here, mostly of reptiles and mammals, but also some birds as well. I saw this bug speeding around, and now that it's been spotted, it's staying still. I'm talking about this little scorpion down here. And when I say little, I mean it. This is a Compsobuthus species. Handling buthids is generally quite a stupid idea, especially out here in the Middle East. But these scorpions of this size, basically every single one I've ever handled, has a really difficult time stinging through human skin. And on top of that, for some reason, smaller scorpions tend to be less defensive. And by the way, I should mention that this is an adult. But in any case, Compsobuthus is not known to be dangerous. And these Compsobuthus are sort of my sworn enemy in this area. I really wasn't expecting to see one of these in this habitat. Compsobuthus are generally not samophiles. They tend to avoid very sandy habitats. And when they can be found on sand, there are usually rocks somewhere nearby, which is not the case here. I think the only reason that we've encountered this one is because this valley between the dunes is connected to the more standard desert habitat nearby, and this area functionally doesn't really act much like a dune habitat in several ways. So various species that typically aren't associated with sand can be found around here. There's a tiny camel spider scurrying around in the grasses here. I'm gonna take a closer look at it. I think this is a Daesiidae. This should be the smallest species of camel spider, whatever it is, in this dune system, which is quite a contrast to the largest solifugid that can be found out here, and that one is in the genus Galeotes. If they came into contact with one another, this one would be toast. And this is only my second time seeing camel spiders in the family Daesiidae. I was able to see a couple of them in Jordan, but they were very good at escaping into the loose rocks on the ground, so I never got to take a close look at them. And I should mention, both of them were found in the same area that was almost completely devoid of plant life, as opposed to the area that we are in that has quite a bit of vegetation. And while that area was nothing but rocks, the other camel spiders that I saw in Jordan were only in the dunes, so it is a bit of a surprise to me to find this Daesiidae this deep into the dune system. In fact, I think generally speaking, Daesiidae are not well documented from sandy habitats, so this is a pretty cool find. Here it is, our third shield-tailed scorpion. Also an adult, like the first one. I've never been able to figure out why this is, but certain scorpions, especially those living on sand that are ambush predators, will wait for prey with their arms extended outwards instead of in front of them. The vast majority of scorpions will have their arms out in front of them,
for example, the fat-tailed scorpions around here. Meanwhile, these shield-tailed scorpions will have their arms off to the sides. Even though this detail might seem subtle and insignificant, it's so strangely unique that you can even use it to identify certain scorpions. So in this case, in this region of Oman, I can identify this species off of its resting position alone. I disturbed this one slightly right before I began recording, and so it moved slightly and we're not looking at the best example. And because of that, since these scorpions are so common, we'll look at just a few more adults so that I can show you what I'm talking about. I've talked about this scorpion's unique morphology and that it has a relatively unique resting position. There is another aspect of their biology that's fairly rare in scorpions. That being, every time these are brought into a captive setting, they eventually just die. And if there has been some success, it's been quite limited. That'll be all for this one. Let's go find a few more adults, just so I can show you what I was talking about regarding their resting position. There's another scorpion in here. You can see its arms are positioned outwards. I'm not too sure why I said we would look for a few more adults. It's also the juveniles that keep their arms outwards when they're resting. You can see this one isn't all that large at all. And down here, we have another Apistobuthus pterygocercus. And you can see, once again, it is resting in the same position. Oh, there it goes. It is about 6 a.m, and I thought that before ending this video, I'd show you something that I think is pretty cool. And it's just over this hill. This is an animal that, to my understanding, is fairly difficult to find. Here are some tracks further out. This animal has fairly long hands. You can see light tail marks as well. And here's my hand for size reference. All right, I've tracked down our animal. And I apologize for being so shaky, but this thing is so much faster than I anticipated. And it's hiding under this structure. Time for the reveal. Oh, I don't think you can see it quite. Hold on a second. All right, there it is. This is a Varanus griseus, commonly known as a desert monitor lizard. All right, I did manage to get our desert monitor. And this one, even though it is quite large, is only about 2/3 grown. It comes as no surprise that this is the largest species of lizard on the Arabian Peninsula. And the one that we have here is the nominal subspecies Varanus griseus griseus, commonly known as the gray monitor. It's found throughout much of the Middle East and North Africa. It's also the second westernmost ranging monitor lizard in the world. In first place is the Nile monitor, and that's because they can be found in Dakar, the capital city of Senegal, which is the westernmost point on the continent. Meanwhile, I believe these stop on the Mauritanian coast further up north. And these monitors are generalist carnivores, so they've been documented eating rodents, snakes, tortoises, lizards, eggs, bugs, and carrion. They can't really afford to be picky because many of the deserts that they live in, ecologically speaking, are quite desolate. A good example of that would be Kuwait. Compared to that region, the dunes that we are in right now are basically a paradise. And this is one of the monitor lizard species whose saliva has been found to have venomous properties. This one specifically has neurotoxic effects. All right, that's it. You're free to go now. That is all of the Apistobuthus pterygocercus scorpions that we are going to find, especially since it's daytime. But anyway, that'll be all for this video. Thank you for watching.